Hi everybody, and thanks for enjoying this video. Talking about machine learning and vulnerabilities. But first, let me introduce myself. I'm Sebastiano Galazzo, and I deal with artificial intelligence since 20 years now. And I'm the CTO of an Italian-based company named Sistemevo, of course focused on machine learning and AI. Then, I'm also Microsoft MVP for AI category. Well, this session is split in two parts. The first part, we will talk about the best practices that I learned along my path. And the second part is focused much more on vulnerabilities of machine learning. To talk about best practices, I would like to introduce the father of the machine learning, or the perceptron. That is not something new at all, it was invented in the early 50s, and it is basically a classifier. From the perceptron, a lot of algorithms were created along these years, and they can be split in what I call the easy way and the hard way. When talking about the easy way, I mean algorithms like the support vector machine, logistic regression, and so on. When talking about neural networks, that's the hard way. Of course, in my opinion. Pro and cons. The easy way, of course, is easier to use, but when talking about accuracy, here that the neural networks are far way better based on my own experience. Of course, the bad side is that the neural networks are harder to configure and to deal with. Algorithms like the support vector machines or logistic regressions basically try to solve an equation like that, where you have to find some parameters and having as output basically a classification. So when talking about neural networks, basically we have this kind of structure, or an input vector having values between 0 and 1, or minus 1 and 1, 0 or more hidden layers, where each element of the layer is connected with all elements of the previous layer, and then the output layer that of course works like a classifier. We will focus on neural networks because, in my opinion, they produce the best result. And so, when we talk about best practices, of course, are best practices related to neural networks. Well, to do that, let's introduce a simple case where we should classify based on very few elements like the age, the gender, the income, city or political party, if someone will vote for a political party or not. The same thing, of course, can be done to classify if someone will buy or not a product of your customer. So, having a data set like that, you have to build the topology of your neural network. How to do that? Each input element of the neural network must have a meaning. That's you that assign, for example, to the first neuron the meaning of the age. But if the input of a neuron is a value between 0 and 1, or between minus 1 and 1, how to represent the meaning of a 40 years old guy, or how to represent that I'm living in Milan or in San Francisco? Well, the first approach manipulating this data is, for example, to use four neurons of the neural network to represent the age. So, the first neuron is 2 if the age is between 0 and 17, and so on. Other 4 or 2 neurons to represent the gender. So, the fourth neuron of your neural network is true if it's male, and the fifth is true if female, and so on. So, you can easily understand that clustering in this way, the input of your neural network grow a lot. In this case, for example, we have more than 20 parameters. But, of course, we can do some kind of optimization. The first optimization that we can produce is, for example, using just one neuron in data like the age. Because in this case, what I can do is, for example, to assert that the max age available is 100, and then divide the age of your input data between 100. In this case, you have a value between 0 and 1. Something similar can be done, for example, for the gender, because you can use just one neuron to represent this kind of data. How? That's you that assert, for example, that the value 0, it means male, or the value 0.25, it means female, and the value 0.5, it means, for example, I don't want to say, and so on. This kind of technique, it works, because I tried a lot of times, but it works only when you have very few parameters, in this case, for example, 4, that are able to produce a huge gap, in this case is 0.25. So, using this technique, we are already able to reduce our input. But of course, we can do far way better. And so let me introduce the standard deviation. Before I start talking about standard deviation, please be aware that this is not a deep dive or math aspect, but I will simplify a lot the concept in order to allow all people to understand the focus and the goal of this technique. We can think to standard deviation like a parameter that represents how we are far from the average. Then we can calculate the standard deviation to use this parameter like input of our neural network. How to do that? The first step is to calculate the average of our dataset and then the standard deviation based on the provided formula. Well, but what is exactly the input of our neural network? That's that formula. So the real input is the value minus the mean divided by the standard deviation. If we consider these few values like example, what we can see is that the value input is minus 1.23. And that could be strange, because we said the input of a neural network should stay on a range between minus 1 and 1. That's not exactly true. In some cases, to help my neural network, I used values for also between minus 5 and 5. That's because a wider gap helps the neural network to understand better that value. But of course, using this technique must be uniform for all the input. Great, now let's introduce another technique called binary compression. Times ago, in my former company, a team was working on a project where they had to classify if a customer would buy a product or not, and they had very bad data, just the name, surname, the address, and the city, nothing else, not the income or other useful data. They spent months trying to figure out best solution for producing a very good model, but the results, of course, were very, very bad. When I was introduced in this team, the first thing I noticed was that the representation of the concept city was wrong. That's because in Italy we have 8,000 cities, more or less, and they needed an input of the neural network made by 8,000 neurons. This approach is totally wrong. That's because each neuron of the neural network should represent a concept. When you spread that concept to a set of neurons, and that set is very huge compared to the all other parameters, then the neural network is unbalanced, producing wrong results. To understand better, let's figure out that we have 4 parameters for the age, 4 parameters for the gender, and then 8,000 parameters to represent where someone lives. Well, the first thing I introduced is this technique that called binary compression. If we consider that we had to manage more or less 8,000 different values, and 2 elevated 13 is a value that is a bit more 8,000, then we can use 13-bit, a mask of 13-bit, to represent the different city. Well, it worked, of course, because performance improved, but not too much, because the big mistake was in the way people tried to represent that value, because that's the key point. What it means Milan, what it means New Delhi, what it means New York for a math model? Exactly nothing. So what I did is to download a database of all Italian cities having all information about how large in kilometer square was the city, density of people, and all other useful informations. And I used that information in my math model. I deleted the information of Milan, of New Delhi, of New York, and replaced by 4 or 5 more parameters. Why? Because was not important the name of the city, but how large, for example, was the city. If you live in a big city with a high density city, or in a small village in the country, that was the key information. Once replaced the information provided by the customer, that was really poor, suddenly the math model improved a lot, with a high percentage of accuracy. And then here we are at the end of the first part. We can figure out how, thanks to some optimization, we were able to reduce a math model from more than 8,000 parameters to just 5 parameters, 6 parameters, doesn't matter. The point is, I could manage these values without machine learning, just using a sequence of if-then-else. Of course, I'm not telling you don't use the machine learning, because that's not the message. What I want to tell you is that nowadays, if you don't use the machine learning, your project is not cool, and that's totally wrong. Machine learning is very, very powerful, but must be used when really useful. And then 99% of the job is made on data optimization. The machine learning is just the final step. But much more What is really important, the data must be manipulated for the machine, not to be understandable by humans. The main mistake the team did in the previous example was that using 8,000 parameters was easy to understand for them, because machine learning is a black box, and the only thing that you can control, you can figure out what's happening, is the input data. And then they work thinking how their brain think, but that's totally wrong. Doesn't match how it works for the math model. Well, now we can introduce the second part, or the vulnerabilities related to machine learning. Let's imagine you run a website like eBay and you want to prevent people upload forbidden pictures of forbidden items with adult content. The naive approach is, of course, to hire underdeveloped people checking this content. Of course, this is not possible. Instead, the deep learning can check for us, and this is typically a classification problem. The training process is most known. We have a set of images that we use to train our math model, and then we compute the error produced, and using this error back to train our neural network. At the end, when we reach a very good value of accuracy, then we are ready to use it in production. Convolutional neural networks are so powerful nowadays that they are able to outperform humans in classification problems. Well, in front of this kind of performances, my expectation is that if I upload an image whose content has been modified for very few pixels, nothing changes, as it happens for humans. Of course, if we are talking about that, that means that is not always true. In fact, it has been discovered that if you find the right pixel or the part or the portion of image to modify, you can change the behavior. I mean that we'll be able to fool our neural network. But why this? In image classification with deep learning neural networks, each point we are going to classify is an entire image made up of thousands of pixels, and that gives us thousands of possibilities to fool our model. In other words, it means that adding some noises to our original input, we are able to change the final classification. To understand how it's possible, we have to understand how the convolutional process it works. When working with convolutional process, basically what we do is to divide our input image in very small areas, maybe 5x5 or 3x3. That region is named a kernel, which applies some kind of filters. The same filters that you can find, for example, in Photoshop or GIMP, able to identify the age of an image. And in this case, of course, we apply hundreds of that filters. Some are specialized to find vertical lines, other horizontal lines, and all sort of information. All that in order to extract the key feature of our input image. Then the image is reduced with an operation that is named max pooling, and we switch to the next layer, repeating again all this process until we arrive to the output layer. Now let's imagine to add some modifiers to our image, like a very small square. Of course, for humans, nothing changes. We are still able to identify it like a squirrel. But applying the first step of a convolutional process, what happens is that our modifier is replied by 4. Of course, this is just an example to allow you to understand better what happened behind the algorithm. Stuff a bit more complicated. Then we switch to the next layer, and that error is doubled again and again. Now it's useless to continue. It's easy to understand now that because of the deep learning algorithm, how easy it could be to spread a very small error. Maybe you are thinking about how easy it could be to hack a neural network, but honestly, it's not so difficult because you really need a few lines of code and the steps are really, really easy to implement. Here, a snippet of code written in Python. As you can see, there are very few lines of code. You can find the full code very easily on GitHub or googling keywords like machine learning pixel attack. There's really no need to share the code. So, say that I don't want to show you how easy it would be to hack a neural network using code in Python. Because when talking about cybersecurity, the main rule is that we don't have to assert that nobody knows our system and then it's impossible to attack. But honestly, in real life, we use online services like Microsoft Custom Vision or a product coming from Amazon, Google or IBM. So to perform this kind of attack, you need access to the original math model because what we need is to run that model, adding some noises and then checking if this noise was able to fool the neural network, leading it to classify in the wrong way. If not, we have to add some new noises and try again. This is the reason why I don't want to show you this kind of attack using the code. But I will show you how easy it could be simply using the Paint software or Photoshop. So even a 7-year-old children could hack your machine learning model able to outperform a human. But first, let's answer to a question that for sure is running in your head. How to prevent this kind of attacks? So it's not so easy. The first thing you can imagine is to train your neural network with the wrong input or to use, for example, other techniques like the OpenCV. So not techniques not related to machine learning in order to help our models. But this is most useless because, as I will show you, possibilities to fool your network just changing very small parameters are infinite. And second was this discovered that honestly there is nothing to do. Before showing the demo, let me clarify something really important. I will show you Microsoft Cognitive Services because based on my test, based on my opinion, this is the best service you can find in the market. And doesn't mean that it's a problem that affects only Microsoft. Everybody are affected by this kind of problem. For this demo, I trained a model able to classify 3 classes: people, squirrel, and bottle, uploaded with several images taken from the web. Before beginning, let's check if our model works properly and then we load a few images to test. The first one is a squirrel, and we can say that it works properly. The first one is a squirrel, and we can say it works properly. Then we test with the image of a single person, and then with the image of a group of people. As we can see, it works perfectly. But now, let's see what happens if we introduce with Paint or GIMP. In this case, I draw an obliquely blue line across the picture. And here the first interesting result, as the model is still able to classify our image as people, but with a lower accuracy, exactly the 77%, and then I'm a bottle at 23%. Now let's try something different, loading an image with vertical and horizontal lines. As we can see, we have been already able to fool our model because I'm a bottle with accuracy of 95%. Okay, but now what you can say is that I altered the image too much. That's true from one point of view, but let you consider that if below there was a forbidden content, like for example adult material, I would be still able to see the content below. And so the damage for the company, for your customers, would be still high. But anyway, let's say that you are right. Perfectly. Let's load the next image. In this case, I covered all my face with a big white square. So, honestly, is a modifier that is higher than the previous one, and my expectation is that the model will fail. But here the surprise: people with a high accuracy, the 99%. Amazing. Okay, well, now let's continue with another test. What I did is to change the saturation, erasing some colors and changing the color of the line, because you can say, okay, but the blue line maybe is too close with the blue of bottles. Okay, the model answered correctly. That's a great news, but what's important is the accuracy value, because with this modify, the accuracy is almost 91%, and if compared with the previous test image, the most altered image has a higher accuracy. Well, let's continue with something different, uploading a new image. In this case, we have a group of people. Here I tried something different, adding very small noises in some key point of the body. As you can see, the accuracy is very, very good. We were not able to fool our neural network. So, let's begin to change something. Well, here I tried the previous approach, drawing some lines. And be aware that in this case I'm not altering the main content. I introduced some noises in the background, and again we were able to start fooling our neural network. It's still able to classify properly, but with not so an high accuracy. Well, it means that is the correct way. Let's continue. This is exactly the previous image, just but saturation changed. So I enhanced some colors. And what happened? Well, I improved the accuracy of my image, just changing colors. Well, then the final image. I switched from cubes to lines, still altering the background and not the main content, and here the result. Well, this image is classified as a bottle with a so high accuracy of the 93%. What to say? Well, if you wonder how much time you need to find the correct modifiers, what I can say is that everything is based on attempts, so it's impossible to answer properly for all situations, but what I can say is that at most in 20 minutes I was always able to find an hack able to fool my neural network. But it's really important that you understand that it's not possible to avoid these kind of attacks, because as I showed you, possibilities are almost infinite, because you can fool your model just changing a bit the amount of colors in your image, or painting some portion of the background. So, of course, as we already explained, you can train your model in order to classify the wrong content, but you can't assert that it's the final solution. That doesn't mean that you don't have to use these kind of services, or that you don't have to drive your Tesla car, but simply that it depends on your project. If for a very important client, you must be aware of this kind of problem and try to mitigate them. Well, we arrived at the end of this video. I hope that it was useful for you and that you enjoyed it. Of course, thanks to our sponsors, and thanks to the organization for the invitation. For any questions, don't hesitate to keep in touch with me. I will be happy to answer to your questions if I can help you. Bye!